Today, a CEO gets a wake-up call after he goes undercover at his own company.
What I learned more was the leadership crisis that exists in America.
Get the secret to his success. Why is it so hard to lead by love?
They're afraid of being perceived as being soft.
On today's 700 Club Interactive. On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today. Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. It can be a scary thought, finding out what people really think about you. No filters, no lies, just you and the truth. And that's exactly what Joel Manby, the CEO of Hersh & Family Entertainment, signed up for when he was featured on Undercover Boss. Viewers were shocked to see what his employees really thought about him and their company, and just not in the way anyone expected.
Joel Manby went undercover at Silver Dollar City, one of the 26 theme parks he oversees, on the CBS show Undercover Boss. His leadership style drew national attention. Viewers couldn't believe his employees' job satisfaction.
It's not just a place I work, it's my passion.
And were perhaps more surprised to see a boss who really cared.
I have a lot of emotion for Albert. I really respect his passion and energy.
That's great, because you can channel that.
And it definitely makes me want to try to help in some way.
Joel's caring attitude wasn't just for the cameras. It's part of his company's leadership culture. In his book, Love Works, Joel explores the seven biblical principles that guide his corporation and shares how leading with love can turn the business world upside down.
Well, Joel is here with us now, and welcome to 700 Club Interactive.
Thank you. Good to be here, Gordon.
While you were undercover, did you learn anything about your company?
I learned a lot about the company, but what I learned more was the leadership crisis that exists in America, really. Because of the response I got to the program, people were overwhelmed by what they saw, and they wrote us by the thousands. And what they said is they wish they worked for a company that cared about its people. They wish that they worked for leaders like they saw in that program. That was the most impactful thing that happened to me. And as a result, I knew there was some kind of leadership crisis in this country.
It's interesting you put it as a leadership crisis as opposed to job crisis. You know, we hear a lot about, Wall Street's just doing what Wall Street does, which is maximize profits, and, right. And rarely do you see a company praised for valuing its people and valuing that as a long-term asset. Why do you think that is?
I actually think that's exactly the problem, Gordon, is Wall Street is focused in a 90-day cycle. They're focused on quarterly results.
But isn't that the nature of the beast? I mean, if you don't hit your quarterly numbers, your stock price goes down, your investors are mad, your analysts are mad.
To a point, yes. But what I have experienced, and I've seen 20 years of the good, the bad, the ugly in the auto industry, and then the last 10 years I've been with Hersh, and what I have seen is companies that treat their people well, they treat them with the principles of love, which is what we'll talk about. Those companies perform better in the marketplace. It's proven. They may not call it love. They may call it respect, dignity, trust. But those companies do perform better financially. Jim Collins has proven it in his books. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the quarterly results will take care of themselves. I think when you make decisions just for the quarterly results, anybody can boost profit immediately, but they may be hurting the company for the long term. They're destroying the brand. They're destroying the employees' trust. So I do think you have to perform by the quarter, but you got to make the right decision for the long term.
Well, why is it that it seems to be more in the tech industry that you see? I don't think they're going to take perhaps the biblical principles that you're taking,
right.
But they're still saying, we want to value the employee, we want to provide for them, we're going to have the concierge service, we're going to do that. Why is it the tech industry seems to have gotten this more than
that is such a
manufacturing?
Great point. And I actually haven't thought about that, but as you say it, the tech industry is the most competitive industry. That's where the growth is. That's where the highest and best talent is going right now. The best people are going to Apple or Microsoft or the other tech companies. that's the most competitive, they need to treat their people better to keep them. So that should just reinforce my point that if you want the best, you'll treat them well. And the principles of love, if you really break it down, that's what's behind it. If I said it differently, if I said every company needs great people, to have great people doing their best work, you need healthy relationships. To have healthy relationships, it's really the principles of love. It's just nobody wants to talk about it that way. And what I'm trying to do is create conversation in the marketplace that we should talk about it. We should be open about it. We should talk about how people are treated. I just think it's incorrect that we don't do it in the marketplace.
Well, why is it so hard to lead by love? And I think in today's American culture, we're sort of seeing it across the board, whether you're talking about politics or you're talking about manufacturing, startups, small business, large business. Right. It's really hard to say, I'm going to be a leader known for love. We seem to be more interested, I want to be feared
right.
more than loved.
Right.
Why is that?
I think you're correct. And I think the reason is people are afraid of being perceived as being soft. Mm-hmm. And they don't think that they will get the results or the respect they need. The truth is, if you study great companies, great leaders, most of them behave the way I describe in the book Love Works, that where I go through the 7 principles of love. That is the fact. But people are afraid of being perceived as soft. But I can tell you, there's nothing soft about leading with love. I've done the whole General Motors gig where it's just about the financial performance only. And frankly, that's an easier way to lead because you just fire somebody quickly right. if they don't hit it. If you're caring about how your decisions impact people, it's actually a harder way to lead. And I think that's part of the problem, though, is they're afraid of being perceived as being soft.
All right, well, how do you lead by love and not be perceived as soft? What's the answer there?
Well, the main word in the book that I think's misperceived or difficult to do is truthfulness. That's one of the words. And most leaders I see and have seen and been led by are not truthful. Mm-hmm. They don't really tell people, here's where you're not doing well, here's where you're gifted, here's where you need to improve, and if you don't, we'll find another job or another organization where your gifts are better used. Those are tough conversations. Most companies and leaders that I've been exposed to, they just come in and they just fire somebody without having those difficult conversations. That's truthfulness.
Well, those conversations are difficult.
They are very
having
difficult.
Having had them.
I know it. And you know what?
It's very difficult. And then you end up with hurt feelings. You end up with defensiveness.
You do.
And you end up with, I've got to prove you wrong.
But in my experience, if it's handled right and you still reinforce the positives, mm-hmm. you give the people another chance, here's the way out. I have found them to work. Now, I've had to let people go just like you have. It's never easy.
It's the hardest thing you've ever done.
I hate it. I mean, I'm sick the night before, and I think if you're not sick the night before.
And you're worried about their family, you're worried
absolutely.
About them, and you're worried about what's next.
And if you stop being that way, I think you stop being a leader.
I think you stop being human.
Right. You stop being human. That's a better way to put it. But I do think truthfulness is what we're missing. Mm-hmm. So I just think, frankly, it's a misperception. Back to your question of why don't people do it or why are they afraid of it. It's a misperception of what love is. In America, we think of love, usually incorrectly, as the romantic love that Hollywood teaches us. But as you know from the Bible, agape love is a verb. It's a behavior. It has nothing to do with how you feel about people. You could dislike them. You could be frustrated with them. You can still treat them with the principles outlined in Love Works. And what I have found at Hershen Entertainment, we get great financial results as well. We've outperformed every competitor in our industry financially over the last 10 years.
So I imagine your customer service is number one.
Because
that goes through. When people feel that they're loved and they're appreciated, they then have the reservoir to share that with the people that
That's
are
right.
coming to the park.
The enthusiasm of the guest experience never rises higher than the enthusiasm of your own employee.
Let's go back to your book, and it's all based on 1 Corinthians 13.
Yeah.
And one of the keys, I think, that you point out is, in addition to being love, being truthful, love is patient, which is the first thing the Bible says.
Right.
Which, when we think about the word love, patience doesn't come first in our mind.
No.
Why is patience so important?
You're hitting on all the difficult points. You're astute. But patience, what I'm not talking about is patience with poor performance. Mm-hmm. It's being patient with how you handle poor performance. And we have one antidote in our company: to praise in public, admonish in private. We all have to take people to the woodshed. We all have to have that conversation. It's difficult. Yeah. I've seen so many leaders embarrass their employees in front of others. I had it done to me in my own career several times at General Motors. But do that privately and do it in a constructive manner and put them back on their horse the next day, but then always praise publicly. But that's what I talk about in being patient. It's just not losing your cool in front of everybody else, doing it privately.
Love is patient. Love is kind. All right, Dole, great book. If you want it, Love Works, 7 Timeless Principles for Effective Leaders. If you're involved in ministry, if you're involved in small business, if you're involved in large business, I encourage you to get this. It'll change your leadership style. It'll change how you think about people. And when you understand love never fails, then you understand love works. Dole, thanks for being with us.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
All right, well, coming up, a single father with a nearly impossible task: running a small business while raising 6 children. See how he does it, up next.
I started feeling pain between my spine and my shoulder blade. All I had was pain and no relief. There was a sizable mass consistent with a malignant cancer in upper right lung. And that's complex, that's tough stuff. I was walking, talking, but I didn't know how sick I was.
I remembered seeing the ad for Cancer Treatment Centers of America, and I thought, this is the place he needs to be.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The game plan was chemotherapy and radiation throughout the whole period. It was an aggressive plan of attack. I liked that.
We gave him chemotherapy and radiation. He was an amazing patient. He tolerated treatment exceptionally well.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity, and the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
My strength came back. I began to become myself again.
George does have his life back now. He has a life that I never thought he was gonna have.
With the teamwork, the treatment plans, the facilities, the combination of all the aspects of the treatment, I'm so happy that I went to CTCA.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits.
Inside, the fastest selling book series of all time.
Some people call it a love story.
How it's changing relationships.
Women are naturally curious.
It takes sex to a whole nother level.
On the next 700 Club Interactive. For Alberto, life as a single dad in Guatemala wasn't easy. He had 6 children and very little money. But when Alberto lost his job, well, things got even worse.
Alberto became a single parent after his wife abandoned the family.
It has been very difficult for us since she left me, because I had to raise our 6 children on my own. I would worry about them and rush home each day after work.
I was very sad every time my dad left home to his job.
Then Alberto lost his job processing salt, and things grew even more challenging. This is where the family has been forced to live, in a shanty with a dirt floor and walls made of plastic bags.
We were hungry when my dad didn't have money to buy food.
So the first thing that Operation Blessing did was build the family this new sturdy home made of wood, one that will protect them from the elements.
I never dreamed we would have a house like this. I am so thankful to God.
Thanks for our new house. It is very nice. Not like the old one that let the water get in.
When we learned that Alberto had not been able to find another job, we asked him about other skills and dreams.
I have always wanted to have my own bicycle repair business.
So Operation Blessing gave Alberto all the tools and supplies he needed to open a small repair business right in front of his new home. Now he can work and take care of his children throughout the day.
Thanks to Operation Blessing, I have received so many blessings for my family. Now I can enjoy my life with my kids thanks to you.
Thanks to you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, that thanks goes to you because you're the reason that whole family is able to have a hope and a future. If you're not a member, call us and say, yeah, I want to join. I want to be a part of it. I want to be a part of everything you're doing around the world. A portion of every gift goes into the work of Operation Blessing to help people. Another portion goes into the work of CBN International to preach the gospel around the world. We've got 15 television production centers, all devoted to training Christians how to do Christian television in their own culture, in their own language. So we're showing people what Jesus is doing in their country with people just like them, who talk like them, act like them, and God wants his word out there. So we want to preach the gospel to every nation, every tribe, every tongue. We want everyone to hear the good news, and you can be a part of it when you join the 700 Club. So if you're not a member, pick up the phone and call us, 888-777-1999. If you are a member, consider going to a higher club level. We've got 700 Club Gold, which is $40 a month. There's also 1,000 Club, which is $1,000 a year, and that breaks out to just $84 a month. At whatever level God is speaking to you to give, to be part of it, call us now. And when you call and join, I've got something for you. God's plan for America. We're hearing a lot of doom and gloom about America today, and you need to know what God's plan is, how he wants to affirm the covenant made with him by the early settlers, and how we can do it today, how we can turn and pray, and he'll hear from heaven and heal our land. So if you want that, if you want to be encouraged, give us a call, 888-777-1999. Well, up next, he's an entrepreneur who helped build a billion-dollar company. But not long ago, he couldn't even afford to pay the electric bill. Hear how his life turned all the way around when we come back.
It began like every other school board meeting until a man they all knew pulled out a gun.
I got a call and said, Mike, there's a man in the board meeting room with a gun.
I've never seen evil like that in someone's eyes.
People were running everywhere, running for their lives.
But there was a greater force at work that day.
And it was a perfect halo of bullets around my head, and none of them struck me.
On the 700 Club, next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Greg Hart just wanted one thing in his life. It wasn't money and it wasn't fame. It was just acceptance. But one day, after he had lost everything, he wanted something else. Brig wanted to put a shotgun in his mouth and pull the trigger.
Brig Hart has found the kind of success many people only dream about. But long before he led a multi-billion dollar business marketing the health drink Monavie, Brig was a kid with a simple dream.
My dream was to have my dad's attention. Was at the root of everything that was driving me. I just wanted to hear my dad say he was proud of me.
Those words never came. What little attention Brig received from his father was violent and abusive.
My dad was a hard, heavy drinker. Couldn't please him. So that came with physical abuse, mental abuse, statements that caused probably a lot of emotional damage early on because we just didn't feel worthy. A slap in the middle of a conversation was a normal thing, but not just a slap, a backhanded off your feet into the ground.
Brig escaped from the pain on the beaches of Maryland's eastern shore.
Surfing was more important than anything else, including school. I was in school, I was physically, but I was mentally in the waves.
At home, Briggs' family was drowning in fear.
At about 13, I had had enough. The abuse, to some degree, was, I was more scared for my mom, myself. I just couldn't deal with it emotionally. I was a wreck. There was a day I just told my mom, I says, I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna run away. And she actually helped me to pack, and you know, it was hard for both of us, but she felt like it was probably better for me not to be in that environment.
Brig lived with four different families over a six-year period. Though he fled the abuse, he couldn't outrun the anger that consumed him.
The anger was really focused at my dad, and I would drink, I would do drugs. I was on probation for a while just because I had taken something. I got into breaking and entering and just filling a void, I believe, that was pain that I was trying to, I wanted it to go away. Never did.
He graduated high school and sobered up during a two-year stint in the Marines. Then he and his brother opened their own surf shop in Jacksonville, Florida.
My goal was success. I felt like success also was the thing that would get my dad's attention, that would get the world's attention. It's the way to redeem myself. We worked 7 days a week, 8 to 18 hours a day. Ended up having five surf shops, but that's when the economy kind of hit a rough time. Our business almost overnight went south. We didn't know what to do. We were heartbroken that we had worked so hard for naught. And at this time, I turned to drugs and alcohol more. That was my scapegoat to try and take away the pain. Did it work? No. Went into depression.
After his business failed, Brig lost all hope.
I just decided I've lived my full life. It's time to end it. Who's gonna miss me anyway? I was estranged from my parents, my other siblings. There was at a point where I was so depressed, I just said I'm gonna take my life, and I knew how to do it. So I put that shotgun in my mouth early one evening in a drunken stupor. I wasn't afraid of death because I didn't think there was anything beyond it. Right about the time I was about to pull the trigger, the phone rings.
The night before, Brig had met a Christian businessman named Doug.
He says, well, you doing anything important right now? And I looked at the shotgun and I says, well, nothing that can't wait.
The two men met the same day, and Doug became Brig's friend and mentor.
Met this gentleman that offered me an opportunity to maybe redeem myself in business. I thought the answer was money. He noticed that I was living in a situation where I was physically hungry. I was probably about 105 pounds, not looking too good. He fed me, and he knew I wouldn't receive, so he'd leave groceries on my doorstep, wouldn't tell me. I didn't know for a while who it was. That got to me.
One day at a business retreat, Brig heard a message that altered the course of his life.
The gentleman speaking, T. Aldred, was a very successful businessman, realtor out of North Carolina. And he did nothing but take his Bible when he talked about the number one bestseller in the world he was gonna read from. I didn't know what that meant. But he opened it up. He didn't say anything other than he turned to 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, the love chapter, and he just read it, word for word. Something had touched my heart in that. That love he was speaking of was the kind of love that I was probably hoping for my family, for me. A forgiving love, a redeeming love. And he noticed, and I couldn't contain myself, but I was weeping.
The speaker approached Brig.
And I asked him who wrote that. And he says, well, he says, I know the author and I can introduce him to you. And I says, really? I said, I'd like to meet him. He says, well, if you'll bow your head, close your eyes, I'll introduce you to him. I did bow my head, I did pray. I felt a weight lift off of me.
I can't even explain. It was like I was weightless.
That day, Brigg became a Christian. Other Christians at the business retreat shared their stories.
They talked to me about how my past, my sins were forgiven, that God won't even remember they're as far as the east is from the west, that I'm a new creature in Christ, that all things become new. I have a new chance. They told me about a God that's a God of a second chance and a third chance. And I said, wow, I need that. As I drove home, I was throwing the beer cans out the window. I know I littered, but throwing the beer cans, emptied my pot out. I went home a free man, but I've never in 31 years ever gone back to my ways of drugs and alcohol. The miracle was the desire was gone. I had no desire whatsoever. Where I ran to that as a crutch, it was gone. Jesus came in, there was no room for nothing else. Now, I didn't want anything else.
Brigg says God restored his family.
I went to just about anybody that I remembered I had aught with and asked forgiveness, just like my mom and dad, who in time came to know the Lord, because they saw it was real. They saw light in this little guy, this long-haired hippie-type surfer guy that gave his life to the Lord.
Brigg prayed for God to give him wisdom in business.
I made a covenant with God that if he would put me in front of 1 or 100, I would show this 1 Corinthians love with his help to other folks. I wanted to lead them into this life that I was now experiencing, this new hope in Christ Jesus. In 1 year and 3 months, I not only paid all my bills, I entered into a field, an industry that evidently God had called me to, relational marketing, that went to the top of my field in the next couple years.
Today, Brigg and his wife, Lita, are leaders in the Mauna V company. Brigg's new book, Why Not You, Why Not Now, expresses his passion to help others succeed in life.
My life's mission is about ultimate success, knowing God's perfect and divine will for your life and doing it. I minister through my business because that's what God's called me to do. It's a joyful thing. I love doing what God's called me to do. I gave my heart to the Lord. I got a second chance. I met my wife. I have a beautiful family. I have no addictions other than I'm addicted to the love of Christ. But I'm fanatical about my faith. Why? Because it's the only answer in these tough times. Jesus is the answer.
Jesus is the answer, and he's the answer for you in these tough times. All you have to do is accept him. All you have to do is ask, are you there? Could you show me that? Could you show me your love? Could you show me how patient you are? How kind you are? How you keep no record of wrongs? Could you show me that? And he'll do it for you. Just as he did for Brigg, he'll do it for you. You know, I love his story, where he literally doesn't know what's happening in the middle of a Bible story, where somebody picks up, I want to read from the best-selling book of all time, and then asked, would you like to meet the author? And he says, yeah, I'd like to meet the author. And so I'll ask you the same questions that Brigg got asked. Are you doing anything important today? Would you like to meet the author? Would you like to meet the author of you, the one who created you and created you uniquely to have a relationship with him? And he's created good things for you to walk into, just as he did for Brigg. He'll show you that if you just ask him. And just say, Jesus, if you're there, if you love me, could you show me? Could you be that for me? Could you be Messiah for me, my Savior? Could you do that? And if you'll pray that with all of your heart, he'll answer and he'll come in. If you want someone to pray with you, all you got to do is call us. We're here for you. The number's toll free. We're here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All you have to do is pick up the phone and call. 888-777-1999. And remember that prayer. Jesus, if you're there, come into my heart. Show me how much you love you. Well, that's all the time we have for this program. We leave you this great word from 1 Corinthians. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these his love. God bless you. We'll see you again.